Good evening. I'm Amy French. I'm the Chief Planning Official for the City of Palo Alto. Many of you have received a flyer about tonight's meeting here, the community workshop. We've engaged a consultant, Paige and Turbull, are here with me tonight, and they will give you a presentation. Just a couple of housekeeping items. This is an open meeting. It's not a public hearing, per se, not as formal as all of that. So we're not going to do the 3 minutes speaker, the podium, like we do at council. We have some goals here, and we can go over those. One thing I would like to say is that there is a cafe over here, Ada's Cafe. They're not paying me to say this, but they do close at 7, so if anyone is, feeling like they'll be faint with lack of food, I believe they serve food and drinks over there. We do have some waters at the back. So, we have an agenda. Those of you may pick those up at the back. We're going to have a brief presentation for myself about why we're here, and from our consultants, Paige and Turnbull. We're going to go over what the project is, and a little bit about the history of Eichler in Palo Alto. And then we'll make sure that you understand what the exercise is tonight, the workshop, of how we're going to proceed with that. So just to kind of put a starting point to the two-story home review process, that began in the year 2001 when the city created the individual review program. We have guidelines. There are currently 5 guidelines in our individual review guidelines. And they apply to new two-story homes and second-floor additions to existing one-story homes. For one-story homes, only a building permit's required. There's no design review whatsoever. Simply review in accordance with the zoning code development standards. So what happened more recently is we kind of opened up the field for folks to come in with single-story overlay proposals, rezoning proposals, by removing the fee that went with that, because there had been some homes coming through in Eichler neighborhoods in particular that did not seem to be compatible, and it seemed that the individual review guidelines were not working well enough in those neighborhoods. And so what the council did when it was looking at some of these single-story overlays is they suggested and directed staff to go ahead and develop Eichler-specific guidelines or regulations that could complement or substitute for a single-story overlay designation, because there were several single-story overlay proposals that were not successful due to an erosion of support by the owners. So then at the end of 2016, council did approve a contract with Paige and Turnbull, and we're going to talk about that tonight. So the existing planning tools that we have in Palo Alto are zoning regulations, the development standards such as setbacks, height, daylight plane, floor area ratio. We then also have the single story overlay combining district. It's a zone legislative act that council approves. If it's requested by the neighborhood, it's certain specifications. And then we have our individual review process and guidelines, as I mentioned. Another aspect about Eichler neighborhoods in town is we do have 2 historic Eichler districts, one in Green Meadow and one in Green Gables. So our goals. Our goal is to develop illustrated guidelines to preserve distinctive character of Palo Alto's Eichler neighborhoods while improving and developing residential properties. We want to have a design tool for both homeowners and architects and to assist the city as we look at proposals that come through. It can become a reference for review bodies, decision makers, and it will assist the community in determining whether we're going to go ahead and establish any kind of regulations. The phrase Eichler zones has come up during that single-story overlay process. So this is where specific standards would apply, maybe in lieu of addition to the existing Eichler individual new guidelines. I'll turn it over to Paige and Trouble.
Thank you, Amy. Good evening, thanks for joining us. My name is Ruth Todd. I'm an architect and a planner and a principal at Page and Turnbull. We're a almost 45-year-old architecture and planning firm based in San Francisco. We started our firm rescuing Victorian houses from urban renewal days and have continued to work on historic buildings or historic contexts and neighborhoods. We've done a lot of work over the years to produce design guidelines specific to historic architecture. And we recently completed for the city design guidelines for the Professorville neighborhood. We are, as I mentioned, we're an architecture and planning firm. This project is run out of our cultural resources studio, which is composed of architectural historians and planners. The primary staff on this project I'd like to introduce now, Christina Dykus and Jonathan Rush, and you're going to hear from them primarily for the rest of the evening. We've got a brief presentation to talk to you about the history of Eichler neighborhoods, why they're important, why they're significant, not just in Palo Alto, but as an example of modernism throughout the United States. And then we're going to walk you through some participatory exercises. This is the kickoff meeting for the project. So we've only done research so far, and we're anxious to hear from you so that you can inform us on how these guidelines should develop. So I'm going to turn this over to John Rush. Oh, before I do that, how many of you live in an Eichler? Okay. How many of you, and how many of you like your Eichlers? Okay, good. That's a good start. Thank you.
Thanks for your floor. So again, my name is Jonathan Rush. I'm an architectural historian with Page and Turnbull. I'm so happy to see so many people who have come out tonight. I'm going to start with a brief overview of the history of Eichlers in Palo Alto and California. So this is Eichler 101. Many of you are probably already experts, so just bear with me. But I want to start with the question, why Eichlers? And why are Eichlers interesting to us? Why are Eichlers significant? Why are they significant parts of Palo Alto's fabric? And I think that one answer to that question is that Eichlers and Joseph Eichler, the man responsible for the Eichler neighborhoods here, really represent an interesting period in our nation's history where design and new technologies and materials and other types of consumer gadgets were being introduced at a mass scale to the middle classes of Americans, promising to make people's lives better, happier, more fulfilled. So Eichler, Joseph Eichler, saw that using houses and neighborhoods as a whole would be one way to make this possible. He certainly wasn't the first person to think about this using modernist design to improve the lives of many people, but he certainly did it at a really immense scale that wasn't matched in other portions of the country. So here, we can all call to mind the kind of typical image of the smiling nuclear family of the post-war era in Sabatini and Eichler. We also see a map of several of the Eichler the cities in the Bay Area that came to be home for Eichler neighborhoods. That's not even all of them, but Palo Alto was certainly there. He was also involved in a couple of neighborhoods in Southern California, outside of Los Angeles and in Orange County. So he built, his company, Eichler Homes, built over 11,000 homes in California between the late 1940s and early 1950s and the 1970s. Of those 11,000, over 2,500 were in Palo Alto. So in many ways, this big experiment for housing and being able to market modernist design, progressive modernist design, has its epicenter in Palo Alto. And this map shows just how much of the city is really covered by the Eichler neighborhoods. We counted over 30 concentrations of Eichler homes in the city, which is really, really astounding, thinking about the fraction, or I mean, it's the portion of the city that is that contains Eichler's. Going back just to cover the real history, Joseph Eichler was born in 1900 on the East Coast in New York City, and he did not start his career in real estate development or as a merchant builder, as the profession was known. He actually had more of a traditional business career at first. I think his company that he worked for was like butter and milk wholesale supplier. So he started in that career, and in the 1920s, he and his family moved to California. And only after 20 more years working in that field did he have a change in direction. And there was a bit of a shakeup at his company, and he left in the mid-1940s. And at a period when he was looking for something new to do, he was actually living in a Frank Lloyd Wright house in Hillsboro and was influenced by the high-quality design, certain design aspects there, and started thinking about how to market high design, high-quality design, to a wide consumer base. So in 1947, he started his first company. It quickly became known as Eichler Homes. And his first neighborhood that he developed in Palo Alto was University Gardens in 1950. Of course, Joseph Eichler himself was an architect, and he wasn't responsible for the designs of the homes. For this neighborhood, he hired a draftsperson to draw up the plans. And it's identifiably modernist through the kind of basic massing and the overhanging eaves, but it doesn't really give a clear direction of what was to come. So that you can cue the architects that he hired on subsequent projects. The firm that he's probably most closely associated with is Anshin and Allen, which was based in San Francisco. And Anshin and Allen met, I think, at the University of Pennsylvania as students, and they bonded over their interest in modernist design at a time when it was not the primary thing that was being taught to architecture students in the United States. So they brought that interest to California, a place that was very well suited for these new thoughts about design and lifestyles in the first half of the 20th century. So when Joseph Eichler hired Anshin Allen to draw up house plans, they definitely brought a more forward-thinking and distinctive style. And you can see that some of their work here on one of their earliest neighborhoods, Fair Meadow. Anshin Allen wasn't the only architecture firm that was hired by Joseph Eichler. They were joined by Jones and Emmons at a time, actually, there was a little bit of a disagreement between Eichler and Anshin Allen. So he brought on Jones and Emmons, and he resolved his dispute with the original firm. So after that point, he had a team that really functioned with both Anshin and Allen and Jones and Emmons. But there was a period when they were designing neighborhoods entirely, like such as Green Meadow. And from that point onward, they kind of worked in tandem, and their plans were available to any buyer for Eichler neighborhoods. And then there was yet a third firm or an architect, Claude Oakland, who was brought on at a somewhat later point. And you can see his designs in some of the later neighborhoods, particularly in Palo Alto, including Los Arboles Edition number 2. So all this means that with this team of designers, that there was a strong familiarity with modernist architecture precedents and a high pedigree of modernist architecture that Joseph Eichler wanted to make available to many, many people, as I mentioned. So here's an ad from the 1950s for the Walnut Grove neighborhood. And as you can see here, a home was available for less than $20,000. And there were some neighborhoods, I think Fair Meadow, you could get one for less than $15,000 to begin with. And for veterans and GIs, they even had better deals where I don't think that any down payment was required in some cases. So affordability and availability to the middle classes was a very important concept behind Eichler Homes. And I'm sure that you all know that the numbers have changed just as much. Another important concept was community. And as you can see here in this plan of Fair Meadow, it was a real progressive idea about how to arrange people, not just in their homes, but at the neighborhood scale. So here, these concentric rings that are very distinctive kind of lay out a way that people might interact or feel like they're part of a unit. Also, Green Meadow Community Center is, I think, a really clear indication of Eichler's desire to provide community amenities through park space and recreational facilities that would be located at the center of a neighborhood and could be enjoyed by all. It's also important to mention that Eichler Homes had a policy not to discriminate by race or religion, which was not completely common at that point, and it led to some disagreements between Eichler and other people in the industry who had different views. So with that in mind, I'm going to discuss some of the overarching concepts or design concepts or things that you find in Eichler neighborhoods that underlie the designs of the houses. So one of the primary things is the construction technique for Eichler homes, which is post and beam on a concrete slab. This has two advantages. It was recommended by Eichler's architects. First of all, to be very affordable and could be reproduced quickly to create the neighborhoods very, very fast. The second advantage was that this scheme allowed for a lot of flexibility in the interior arrangement of the home, so that, as we'll discuss in a couple of slides, the spaces at the interior could be changed. They didn't need partition walls to divide spaces, and there's kind of a free-flowing movement throughout the spaces. I think that one of the interesting things about going through an Eichler neighborhood is seeing the textures. Even though that there are many similarly scaled one-story homes, the roof forms are very, even though you see repetition, every house seems to have a little bit of a different take. And so you see some similarities with the low slope gable and the flat roof, but then those are interspersed with interesting things like the combination roof forms that offer an asymmetric design, in addition to some of these really distinctive roof forms like the chevron one that was designed by Claude Oakland, and I think that's in the Green Meadow Unit Number 3 neighborhood. Materials are also very distinctive. Of course, I'm sure that you all know that the vertical wood boards, tongue and groove, are very typical to Eichler's, and I don't believe that there was any particular width that was original, but that the Eichler catalog provided many different widths that you could choose from. In some instances, the vertical wood board was paired with an area of concrete block, as you see in the top example here. Because of the post and beam construction, a lot of the houses have exposed rafter ends or beam ends that are underneath the widely overhanging eaves. That's very identifiable with Eichler's. And then lastly, of course, garages play a very important role in the designs of the houses. Given the time that these houses were being built, garages were always on the front facade. You either had a one-story garage, two-story garage, or in some cases a one-story garage with one of these recessed carports. And in this case, the carport leads to a glass wall that encloses an interior atrium or courtyard space.
Didn't really mean two-story garage.
Yes, oh, I'm sorry. Yes. You guys are sharp. The window patterns are also very important in the design of Eichler's. So some of the first designs had a fairly typical, you know, maybe a pairing of windows on the front facade. But as the designs progressed, there was a minimization of the windows on the front facade. So in this instance on the top here, you have the long, tall, narrow windows that, just two of them, which seems kind of unusual that there's such a wall between or barrier between the private space of the interior and the public street. On the example below, there are no windows apart from these clerestories that are above the garage. So nothing that would allow somebody to look in at kind of average height and see what's going on inside. However, that's contrasted very sharply with what happens at the rear facade, which is full height glazing in this really beautiful photo, which fostered the family's ability to go in and out of their house and enjoy the California climate, and really allowed a kind of a seamless indoor-outdoor living, which again is a very important concept behind Eichler homes. There's some other strategies that were used to facilitate this. One of them was through interior atria, where you would have a patio space that was surrounded on all sides by the house, with the roof broken above to allow in light and air. And then in other cases, there might be a courtyard at the front entrance, even if it's on the front facade or perhaps on the side. And in this case, it's a really beautiful example with the tree that was growing through the roof, the break in the roof. And then lastly, as I mentioned before, the interior arrangement of spaces is very characteristic of Eichler's. And it leads to or it comes from the idea that no space inside at the center of the house should be clearly defined by its use. So actually, one of the characteristic spaces was the multi-purpose room, sometimes placed right next to the kitchen. So in the newspaper advertisements, you read about the happy housewife in her kitchen, and she's able to look over and see her children playing right there. And that multi-purpose room would lead directly into the living room or the combination living room and dining room. So this very able to circulate freely within the home. And then from that core space, then the bedrooms and the garage were located at the ends of the home floor plan. So that's my very brief overview. And now I'm going to hand it over to Christina.
Thank you, John. So I'm going to talk a little bit about this project, the design guidelines for Eichler's. And then I'm also going to talk about our activities for tonight, which will be interesting because we have many people in the room, but we can discuss that in a little bit, how that might work. This slide shows a potential table of contents, if you will, for the design guidelines, which we have not begun yet. This is our kickoff meeting. We want to receive feedback from you, the community, before we really dig into preparing the design guidelines. We want to understand your values and the information that you would want to see and so on.
Will you be posting these images online?
For
the slideshow you're presenting?
Presentation? Well, we are recording it right now, so I understand that
that
will be...
I don't want to have to go through a video. You can post the presentation online.
Yeah, we can put this presentation on the website.
Thank you.
But a general potential outline for the document would have an introduction, how to use the guidelines and methodology behind how we've prepared the document. A little bit of history and architecture, probably similar to what John has just prepared for this presentation. And then really getting into these guidelines to include a chapter about maintaining, repairing, and replacing materials. Another about altering or adding on to residences. Another about designing and building new residences within Eichler neighborhoods. And finally, a chapter about site improvements, whether that covers accessory structures, landscaping, paving of driveways and walkways, etc. So those are some general concepts that we might include. And in our next activity, which I am about to talk about, you'll be able to provide some feedback about information that you'd like to see in the guidelines related to those chapters. So this is our schedule for our project. Here we are at the top, April 2017, first community workshop. Through the summer, we will also be considering potential zoning and code changes. Amy mentioned that, you know, we would like to receive feedback from you, the public, about whether these guidelines, which are suggestions for treatment of construction within the Eichler neighborhoods, should also potentially feed into future changes in the zoning or code, regulatory changes, if you will. Through the summer, we're hoping to have some neighborhood tours and other outreach activities, and one of our boards that we have up here will be for you, the neighbors, to sign up if you're interested in participating with us on this. We will be working on this draft document during that time, and it will be available for public review in August so that you will be able to read it and provide comments back before we finalize it. So we'll have a second community workshop in September where we will seek feedback from you. We will have an informational hearing and presentation to the Historic Resources Board also in September and seek commentary from them. In October, we will hopefully be presenting to the Planning and Transportation Commission, and again to receive feedback, and all along incorporating changes into this draft document. So that by December, we hope to be able to present to the City Council so that they consider adoption of the design guidelines. And if we decide to go that route, potential zoning and code changes. So we are hoping to be able to wrap up this whole project by the beginning of next year.
Let me ask a question. What, the final product, design guidelines, are they mandatory? Are they regulations? Are they voluntary? Can you give me a sense of what teeth they have?
Sure. Well, at this point, we are considering them not mandatory. But the consideration of potential zoning or code changes could tie into these guidelines to make them more of a mandatory document or something that has teeth. Amy, do you want to chime in?
Just adding to that, again, we have, as you know, as I mentioned earlier, the individual review program process. To the extent that a new two-story home were to come and propose to locate in an Eichler neighborhood and tear down the home, I think we have some goals to have better, stronger tools than what we have now, which is the individual review guidelines. It's not very. It has some mention of looking at the neighborhood pattern and trying to fit in, but when we're talking about a track of Eichlers, it's not, every home is a custom home. We're looking at the neighborhood. And so it's kind of a different need that we have when we come to an Eichler neighborhood with those individual view applications. So we'd like to get something that's stronger. And I'll just say that from a staff standpoint. And we would have council direction to move forward, or we would need council direction to move forward with a regulatory legislative type of document.
So at this point, we just hope to receive feedback from you about whether that's something that you would desire. And I think one of the questions that we have up here for our first assignment relates to that. We'll go through that in just a bit. Yes?
The state just passed new regulations on accessory dwelling units. And how is that going to fit into these guidelines, because there's some rules about whether you can or cannot have design review and stuff like that. So
that could certainly be a portion of our report if we want to be in there.
I think we're going to need to get a little bit more clarity on what the final direction is.
When we
talked about accessory buildings, it was not more living units. It was much more of smaller storage sheds or something like that. So we'll have to see. We can mark it down. It'll be something that we consider. At this point, until you mentioned that we weren't prepared to address it, so.
Because it's going to be a big issue.
Wouldn't that be added to the guidelines for altering or adding to residency?
It could, yes.
What we most want is not available in the present guidelines, which is protection of privacy, minimizing the total height, and minimizing the bulk of the house, and making it fit into the neighborhood. Those are the things you can't get at all in the present guidelines.
Well, if there are additional comments like that, we are hoping to seek those through our next activity and then discuss them later. So if there are any kind of procedural questions at this point, yes.
I do have one procedural question. So the contract that was approved by the City Council back in November stated the existence of an advisory committee. I'm wondering what the status of that advisory committee is and who the members are, and has it met? Because according to the schedule at the time, that was supposed to have been constituted and meetings held before this first public review. What's happening with that?
It was decided that we would proceed with this without having an advisory committee, just that we would develop an interested parties, email group. And so that we did, and that is how we sent the flyer out through this email group.
The flyer was, the only reason I got it was because it came to me through the, what is it, this neighborhood chat line thing.
Yeah, that's definitely
the one. There was no attempt.
We supplemented our effort by contacting those who have, unless you're a Palo Alto resident, you can't belong to a next door or what have you. So we relied on others to help us get the word out. We developed an initial list of interested parties, and that's how we were able to get.
I personally came to you, and I still didn't get noticed.
I'm sorry for that. We'll make sure we have.
And it didn't show up in the Palo Alto Online until Monday, yesterday.
And we've got
a room that's got room for 60 people in it, and we've got, how many homes did you say in Palo Alto? 2,500?
We received 47 RSVPs to what we sent out. So I'm sorry for those who are standing, but this is not the last opportunity.
So, I mean, you know, in terms of collecting our inputs from the members of this community who live in and are concerned about Eichler's,
I would like to say that we're very thankful that these people are doing this in the first place. So
I don't disagree with that, but there are very few of us that are here.
We do have a sign-in sheet at the back, and we hope that you will leave your name and contact information, and we will add that contact info to our list that we currently have. But let's continue on so we can stay on schedule. So this is how our night will unfold. We have two activities. I'm going to explain the first one. We'll have half an hour to do the first activity. Then we'll have a 5-minute break, and then we will gather back again and explain the second activity and undertake that one. So those of you who are sitting in chairs should have a little stack of Post-its. You'll also have some dots, sticker dots. You can hold on to those for now. The dots are for the second activity. But you will need your Post-its. And you'll see that we actually have two posters on the back wall. And we have 8 posters over here on these sliding doors. And they have a total of 10 questions on them that we would like your feedback on. The questions are also on the agenda. If you didn't pick up an agenda, there should still be some copies in the back by the sign-in sheet, so you can potentially just sit at your chair, since we do have a lot of people here, and look at the questions that are on the agenda, fill out your answers, and then eventually go and stick your Post-its up on the board. So this is really to elicit your feedback about these questions. If you can put one comment per Post-it. You don't have to put your name down. If you need more Post-its, we have more at the back. And I think that is that clear for everybody?
You don't want to use the Post-it, you can write
directly on the handout. You
can't
use
pens to anybody. Lots of pens. We have plenty of pens and Post-its.
Okay, so 30 minutes.
Thank you very much for your feedback. If you'd like, as we move on to the next activity, you certainly have time to read through all of these Post-its and just draw a little star next to ones you really agree with. But we're going to move on to our blue and red dot activity. This is activity number 2. It's going to go a little differently than the way we've described it here, because we ended up not really having room in this space for tables. But what you have are 8 blue and 8 red dots. If you had a seat, you would have found your dots on the seat. If you don't have dots, John has some that you can pick up in a little bit, but he'll pass them out. We have a series of images that I know some people have already been looking at up at the front here. So I will briefly describe what they are. We have an image here. Hopefully we can kind of move this thing out of the way a little bit. but it has some of those general characteristics of what we have in Eichler neighborhoods with different forms of roofs and that kind of combination. We have the map that we showed in our PowerPoint presentation if you just want to take a look at it and all of the Eichler tracts. And then we have some examples of alterations that have occurred to Eichlers. And what we'd like for you to do with each of these four posters here is that if you really like one of the alterations or what the other posters show, then you put a blue dot next to that picture. If there's something that you don't really like, you put a red dot. And that'll help us kind of gauge, you know, what people's opinions are about changes that happen and kind of help us to shape our design guidelines. So we have some examples of alterations on this poster. Some door, garage door and window replacement, wall cladding replacement, and just a variety of other alterations. Then over here, we have examples of second story additions. We have full width additions, partial width additions, and narrow additions.
Have you had a big red dot for that?
We have non-Eichler infill and new construction in just a moment.
Sure.
And just some examples that we took pictures of buildings that aren't Eichlers that are in Eichler districts. Some one-story non-Eichlers and some two-story non-Eichlers. And then last over here, we have some examples of landscape and site improvements, some driveway and walkway paving options, different kinds of stone and brick and other things like that. Landscape treatments, whether it's, you know, lawn and shrubs or kind of drought-tolerant landscaping, low ground cover. And then down here, some examples of fences and site walls that we've seen in the neighborhood. Yes?
If all of us come and put a dot on those pictures, we're not going to be able to see them.
Yeah.
Yes.
No, besides, we're underneath.
We'll get like a real
stack of dots. Yeah, or you can kind of put them, you know, all in the, right on the underneath. We'll see how that goes, to your point. And the way that we'd like to proceed with this, because there are so many people and you're going to have to look at these small pictures, is that we're going to call up by row, sort of like a dinner buffet, if you will. So we'll start with row one and so on. So one of the reasons why we've decided to forego the 5-minute break is that we'll probably be spacing this activity out just a bit. So if you need to take a break to use the restroom or get a bottle of water, you can do that while some other people are up here at the front. Yes?
If you really don't like the concept of something like the second story, can we just put the dot in that blank white space, which will go for a general thing as opposed
sure.
to by a picture?
Yeah, you could,
also,
you know,
you can write notes on
yeah.
this.
But you can even take some of your posts.
If you feel strongly about something, it should show up as, you know, red or blue. Or it should certainly show up over here.
Mm-hmm. Yes, in that.
Do you think it would be possible to post these somewhere in City Hall? I think this would be these dots, not all those half dots. I think it's going to be cumbersome. Could they be posted also in City Hall so that we can come down when it's convenient?
There's this thing called the web also.
Right.
Yes.
SurveyMonkey?
We'll see how much comment we're able to receive tonight, and we will definitely accept any ideas for additional methods of feedback following this meeting. Any other questions before we begin this exercise? And then what we'd like to do after everyone has put their dots on, and again, if you don't have dots, John has additional dots, is that we would like to kind of wrap up towards the end of the evening by just having some discussion that Ruth is going to help facilitate, just reading some of the common comments and, you know, some things that we're drawing from that we will hear from you tonight. But for right now, for the next time, half hour, give or take, we'll see how it goes, and if we need that much time, we'll just be sticking the duff on. All right, so row one, if you will.
Yeah. We're watching.
If you would like to, they're just sort of general.
Zubros. How about Zubros?
Zubros, there's plenty of space.
Okay, we're doing well.
New modernist design within the Eichler neighborhood. That seems to be a pretty consistent theme, and that you are much more open to the front yard landscape areas of these neighborhoods. That, excuse me, if you like second story additions at all, you like them small. And discreet. That's my first impression of just a very quick glance here. The other thing that I wanted to do is just tell you, I wrote a few notes after reading, I think almost all of the posted notes, to give you a sense that I think that there is a good bit of consistency of opinion that's been expressed tonight in the answers to our questions. So hopefully that's going to make our task easier, but this is just community meeting number one, so we'll see. In terms of what you feel is special or unique about Palo Alto's Eichler neighborhoods, I think overwhelmingly you like the sense of community and the cohesion that the Eichlers offer. You like the neighborhood, and the sum of the parts as opposed to one particular individual home. As far as the individual homes, you appreciate privacy and openness. And you appreciate the clean, modernist approach. That's something that was very consistent throughout. In terms of the design features, again, you like the modern style. I think it's really, it's open-minded of you to embrace kind of neo-modernist approaches, especially to infill for the Eichler neighborhoods, and that you like the openness and the privacy, which is also what I said back here. And that openness and the privacy, I think it goes back to one of the characteristics that John was explaining earlier, is that there's a really good indoor-outdoor relationship that the Eichlers offer that is pretty unique. What you like or not like, this one was a little bit harder to read because you made the comment, but not everybody said whether they liked or disliked the comment. But I think in general, again, the common theme is consistency, a modernist approach to change. And then there is a lot of passion expressed about one story versus two story levels in the Eichlers. In terms of the, would you like the design guidelines to address maintenance issues? I think I got the impression that people would appreciate it, but they're not necessarily passionate about that as part of our design guidelines. But it's certainly something that we can address. And I think some of that is in terms of a lot of the comments appreciated the repair and replacement suggestions in the guidelines in the vein of if you're making changes as opposed to, you know, an accurate repair. I think that most everyone admitted that they live in an Eichler because they love it, but a lot of times they bought the house also because it was affordable. And that the neighborhood character was also a factor in how they feel about their individual home. This is asking the question that will about the types of guidelines that will likely end up in our document about siding, height and massing, plan, roof shape, materials. And I think in general people were open to getting guidance on all of those things, but that the overwhelming message that I interpreted was that you want a sense of unity in your neighborhood, you want to protect your privacy, you want changes to fit in, again, to be modernist, not neo-traditional or something that doesn't blend with an original Eichler, and then again, the mention of single-story versus two-story. Should the guidelines provide more specific guidance to the two National Register districts or Eichler neighborhoods? And there was kind of a maybe, maybe not, so not a very strong message to give us on that. In terms of the design guidelines, our question is, it's intended to be a helpful document, and we hope that's going to be the case. And would you like for the city to establish regulations or code amendments? And in general, from what I interpreted here, is that there was an overwhelming support for strong guidelines and changes to regulations and the codes as needed to protect what it is that you've expressed that you care about. There were three opposite opinions, but in general, you're open to regulation. In terms of other important points or issues, this is probably going to be the hardest one for us to deal with. I think that we've been hearing some terms mentioned here about making the points about having something that's a balanced guideline versus something that's a little bit more strong and assertive. And something that's very specific versus something that's generally balanced. So we're going to have to chew on this one for a while. There was also mention that several of the neighborhoods have ACCs,
CCNRs,
and CCNRs, and we will do some research about what they are so that we can bring forward any contradictions or any way to reinforce something that's already codified, I assume, still. And then several of you are open to participating or helping to organize the keepers. So I don't think I got it too far off. Is there a question?
Well, it's a comment, and it's somewhat important. So on the second story edition poster, there's one picture that has some blue dots, but that was not a second story edition project.
It's an original.
No, it's not. It's actually a whole new house. So it's the only one on that poster that has blue dots, but it's not on the right poster.
Okay.
So it was a full build, it's infill construction, not an addition. Okay.
Well, no, but it actually shows how difficult it is to just add a second story to an existing Eichler.
There is one neighborhood with original two-story.
Yeah.
Right.
This one that you didn't like. It's original.
They're really nice on the
inside. But they're all about that. They were designed so. Right.
So they're built in context.
So should we ask the question, how do you deal with your desire to maintain a single-story neighborhood amid the real estate pressures that and the size that might force someone to go up rather than out if they needed to expand their house?
Single-story overlay.
There are neighborhoods that have single-story overlays, and what the city does is it allows that neighborhood to have as much square footage on a single-story as they would be able to in two stories. So you're actually losing about 300 square feet if you go up, because that's the amount of the stairway on two floors, which is counted on both floors. Okay. So you get more usable space by staying single floor in a single-story overlay. If the city would just allow everyone to do that, then
okay, I see a lot, not a lot, but I see heads nodding.
Yeah.
Okay.
You're asking how do you protect from single story?
No, I was just saying how would you want us to deal with it if someone needed more space and wanted to go up rather than out.
One option is going down.
Yeah, it's never basements. You can build a basement anywhere.
No, you can't.
I mean, engineering-wise, you can put a basement anywhere, and you can make them sealed now. They don't mold.
It's just more difficult to put a bedroom in a basement because you have to have egress.
There are designers who know how to do all of these things.
I think you have to focus on the placement of windows and find a way to maintain the privacy, right? So if you go and tour some of the second story neighborhoods that are built, that privacy is still there. So I think that's the goal. I put a blue sticker on the one house on the right there where there was a second story with windows facing the front. Fine, you want to add a second story, all the windows should face the street, not into your neighbor's backyards. You know, I think that's, you can address it through window placement, landscaping, fencing, other things like that. You can make an attractive second story. It was the one on the top right that I put the blue sticker on.
I would amplify that and simply say that the neighborhoods, when they were designed by Eichler, whether they're single story or the one or two places where there's two story Eichler, they were designed as an entire entity, and so the privacy was built in to how each of the houses respected each other's sight lines and so on. And the problem that we have now, that you're challenged with perhaps in these guidelines, is how do you preserve that sense of privacy and I like to refer to it as the common space that all of us in these Eichlers share. You know, you can see out for the urban forest, and now somebody comes in, and even if it's just a single story house, they can go all the way to 17 feet, 6.5 feet away from the fence line. Right. I can't, if a house like that went in next door to me, all my windows are on the side, I couldn't see the sky anymore. Right. Out of all my side facing windows. It's the lack of respect of new construction for not only the privacy, which is them looking at me, but my use of the common space, which we all have, which is looking out.
And light.
To the urban forest and the sky and so on.
It sounds sight and light.
So you've got to look at it from both the perspective of the person wanting to build the new place, certainly have a right,
and the right of the people that are there already to preserve what they paid for in good faith and have helped to preserve by being part of the neighborhood.
I agree with that, but I'll give a different perspective. Something like Hampton purchases now, or cash purchases, and the first question they ask is, what's the tallest, biggest house I can build? Because I want my parents to live downstairs. And sorry, grandparents downstairs, parents and children upstairs. It's a worthy objective, but you can't fit it so close together without some sort of sight barrier. There needs to be a solution to the sight barrier, right? Because people that pay the most for the house are going to want to have a two-story in the basement.
They can go to different neighborhoods. Yes. For that. Yes. This is what they want.
Maybe not have information.
I do think the Eichler needs to be protected for this reason. It's really disruptive to the neighborhoods, and then the families who do build a second story, ultimately, it destroys the neighborhood. It's not as attractive any longer, and so then I don't know what it does to our property values. I would like to say one idea that I put on the board for kind of a middle ground solution if they need more area. Maybe the city could ease up on the restriction for requiring a single parking spot in the garage so that people could recoup that area and do it in a way that aesthetically blends in with the garages on the street.
Hidden secret. No one uses a garage.
Yeah, really? that already happens.
That's a really good point. In any case, no one using the garage for the car,
right.
For their car. So to allow converting the garage as a part of the house, it will solve part of the needs for more space.
So 2 points. One is that pretty often if you just allow the front of the house to come forward 6 feet or so, you could provide just about as much space as with the second story once you take away the stairwell. And the second piece is that in our neighborhood there's a number of houses, maybe five, that are canyons because they have a two-story on either side of them and either two-story behind them or industrial behind them. They shouldn't have the same restrictions that other unlocked houses have. They should be grandfathered just as much as the two stories that are making them into a canyon. So you need to think about those, you know, it's a small number, but those are the people that tend to be the angriest about the two-story overlay because they have nothing to gain and they've already lost it all to the two canyons on either side. So really look at those houses. One is like, it has Eichler Swim Club behind it and it's got a two-story house on either side on Greer.
So you're saying they need to be more protected or less protected?
They should have the right to build up if they wanted to, because they're not gaining anything.
Some individual site review.
So they lost the...
20 or 30 years ago, they lost whatever we're trying to preserve.
So what she's trying to say is, I mean, you know, I don't know how much your group is aware of the single-story overlay process here.
Yeah.
So there are certain neighborhoods that are either 100% still single-story, or they've already had some of this infill and so on go on, and she's talking about a case where either it was two-story to start or there was some infill,
yeah.
And now you got this got this thing that's neither fish nor fowl. How do you fairly treat people? And that's an important question. Our neighborhood was lucky enough when we were still single-story to get the overlay, and there were no two stories to contend with.
Okay. Well, I think that we haven't necessarily mapped it, but when we, we outlined the boundaries and we have a sense of where cohesion still exists and where cohesion has been lost, I think what I'm hearing is that, you know, in some situations the cat's already out of the bag and that those kinds of situations might need to be identified and treated separately.
In a fair way.
We had a similar situation on Terrea Court, which was some people wanted a single-story overlay, but those of us that own original two-story Eichlers didn't like the verbiage, which made it seem like our houses would become the bastard stepchildren to the rest of the neighborhood, and so it fell apart. Although we had too many two-story houses to begin with, but it was, that was one of the issues with how it was kind of explained.
And non-compliant.
Calling them non-compliant. Really bought people that bought those two-story Eichlers. It just seemed like that was a horrible thing to say.
So what you're really saying is that in your case, if it was gotten designed originally, I'm assuming that the sight lines and so on of the adjacent properties, everything was
cul-de-sac. It's actually laid out well.
Yeah. I'm just going to put a plug in for the CCNR, because I live in Green Gables, and we've been doing battle with Sandhill over the grocery store and holding to what they agreed to. So if you ever see a need for letters to go to city council, to get them to honor their agreement of making sure it's a grocery store, not just a building, please write letters, because I think that's one of the biggest CCNRs in the area, but because I live right near the only shopping center that Eichler ever designed. And what he did was he took a little piece of property from like 90 houses. Now I live on the west side of Wildwood, and those on the east side of Wildwood have a CCNR. My side does not, but it still affects everything they do.
Okay, we definitely will check into that.
Yeah, I guess it's another plug for the existing architectural control committees that are in place that should be consulted about how the city can help us to maintain what we already have in place.
So I just wanted to reiterate, I'm a big fan of building forward towards the street. I think that was like a fundamental mistake of American suburbs. It made things that are not neighborly. The closer you get to the street, the more people know one another, the less they sit back. It's like, one of the problems is like the garage is the dominant element of the house and everything sits back from it. That's one. But also, I'd caution against taking this as any sort of statistics. The demographics in this room are not the demographics of the neighborhoods I know. So, this is some active people at the age profile, the racial profile. I would draw
compassion
statistics from.
I'm not sure what you're really trying to say.
I'm just saying that you're going to do a lot more outreach than having a thing on a Passover night in a library. Like there's a certain class of people who show up, and that's not representative of the whole neighborhood. If you want to make rules for the whole neighborhood, get the whole neighborhood.
So
it's
mostly a question. Look at a lot of Eichlers are in the floodplain, and the restrictions for how high you can build or how high it's a new house, how much it needs to be raised. For those houses, the second story issue, I think it's probably a lot harder to do a second story, but that's something you might actually look at, because I'm just speculating.
Yeah, it is something we noticed. We're kind of in denial about it.
I'd amplify on that point, which is that our neighborhood LLL is transacted by floodplains. So on one side of the line, if somebody did a tear down, they're going to absolutely have to go away from a slab, and they're going to have to elevate that first floor to 2 or 3 feet up, or however far up they have to go to be 18 inches, I think it is, above the high water mark. And now they're staring down across the maximum 7 foot high fence on the side yards into the neighbor's yard because they're automatically taller, whether they're one story or two stories. And this has a very strange effect when it happens. We've just had a house at 905 Elsinore like that happen. It wasn't in the floodplain, but just by elevating up off the slab, it's created a whole different set of circumstances in terms of the privacy of the neighbors. But the slab, but the flood zone thing amplifies that.
A couple
couple other sources you might consider for inputs would be other Eichler communities. I think Sunnyvale has guidelines.
Yeah, we've done the research.
Yeah, and I think probably other ones do because they're throughout the whole, you know, Bay Area, North Bay, East Bay, South Bay. And also there are a few architecture firms that really have become Eichler experts in terms of renovating or rebuilding in a way that is consistent and respectful. Somehow they have figured out the types of elements of the house that works for the neighborhood. And I think their inputs, you know, these are your colleagues and peers, would probably be helpful.
Right, we have a list of those that we want to reach out to.
So that comment actually makes me think of another thing that I'm a little worried about with this meeting. That I really appreciate that all of the Eichlers that I know in Palo Alto are so different, partially because there haven't been these protections in place. And I know that there's a large community of youngsters in California who are really all about the Eichler, and they want the museum to Joseph Eichler, and I don't know that that's necessarily exactly what would be useful for this community. So to have regulations that limit how those houses can be changed would be wonderful in some ways and really disturbing in others, and I don't know how it gets done effectively so that we're not.
This house that everyone seems to like that shows up a few places, is this new construction or is this an idea?
It's a remodel.
It's a rehab?
Yeah.
Okay. So I think that's something that is allowed, that's within your, I think you expressed a concern that is alleviated here by a positive response to a much more contemporary, less Eichler preservation.
I agree, but one of the questions is, should specific guidelines provide more specific guidance for what, you know, for, well, not in this one, but exactly what it means to be an Eichler and how we get to change them. And, you know, not everybody is fond of not having an insulated building that, you know, 8-inch wood panel. Some people are really into just having insulation and drywall. But that's not Eichler-y, so how does that regulation get?
Well, these are not Eichler preservation guidelines. These are Eichler neighborhood guidelines.
That's what
talking
I'm
about exteriors.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's what I'm asking.
So, Christina, I think we've got a few more minutes. Do you want to summarize or talk about next steps?
Amy, do you want to come up as well?
We just have another couple minutes.
We had our schedule up on the up earlier, and our next steps will be to digest all of the commentary. We have an email address that Amy will be checking. It's eichler@cityofpaloalto.org. And we will also be having information on the city's website. We just haven't gotten it up quite yet for this meeting, unfortunately, but it will be up soon.
I went to check, and we do have the website is live, and it does have this capability of summing up. So when we do post our next our next posting, then we can do it. It's still a manual operation, but we can send it out to whoever was signed up on that web page. There's a flyer on there, and there's the map with the Eichlers and the tracks as well as some information. But yeah, next steps, we're in the presentation, so we're going to have May to August, we're going to look through the zoning chapters and have those discussions. But before that, there is a meeting that we're have a small group that's going to be smaller group, perhaps. The two National Register District, they have a specific set of circumstances or regulations that could applied to them because of that status of national register. So that's Green Meadow and Green Gables. And so we're going to have to have a meeting with them.
Could you turn the mic on?
Is it on? I think it's,
okay,
yeah,
maybe my ear.
Yeah, so there is one workshop we're going to have with the Green Meadow and Green Gables folks, focus on the historic districts that they're part of.
Is there a time frame for that?
Or? We're looking at May 3rd down at Green Meadow. Is anyone here from Green Meadow?
Yeah,
okay.
Green Gables.
Green Gables. On people's calendars. And
yeah, we just started looking at that because there were some that couldn't come tonight as well. They have to be in Green Meadow, so we started talking about. So we've secured the room there at the Green Meadow Community Center. So if you are in those neighborhoods, we're trying to put that on the calendar now, but we'll eventually put that on the website.
Well, we'll kick it around maybe next door and then our
Before you head out, hopefully everybody has signed in and included their contact info. If we didn't already have your contact information, we will be adding it. We can only build from here. There will be a lot of opportunities to provide commentary. You can email Amy, as I just mentioned. The email address is at the end of the agenda that you have. With any additional comments or feedback, you can send additional photos of examples of buildings that you like or don't like if we didn't have them up here. We welcome as much feedback as we can have. We will be publishing a public review draft of the document that you'll be able to review once we finally write it and provide commentary, and then having a second community meeting at that point. Maybe we can find a little bit larger room. I anticipate even more people coming for that to elicit feedback on the actual document. And also in the meantime, we're hoping to just do some fun things and get people excited about their Eichler neighborhoods. So if you haven't yet put your name down or contact info under number 10, and you'd like to be part of organizing a walking tour of your Eichler neighborhood or providing a little brochure that we can post up on the website or any number of things that we're happy to kind of brainstorm, then please provide us your information and we'll be in touch with you. Anything else?
What website is live?
Oh, it's the Eichler, it's the same as the
email?
Yes, Eichler at cityofcolorado.org. So,
well, that's the, I guess that's the email, sorry. But if you go to the City of Palo Alto website, and just when there's a search button, you can put Eichler up there. Mm-hmm. It also is on the left column of the Planning and Community Environment webpage. So if you think planning, go to that page, and then look on the left side, you'll click on it there. Yeah, meanwhile, if you just do a search. But.
So thank you for coming out.
Thank you.